Hi everyone, and welcome to this tutorial bite for Oxygen Not Included, which is all about power systems. I'm going to explain how to build and use power systems, which is probably one of the most confusing aspects of the game, as it's not like real life and not well explained. Starting with the basics, the power overlay is found in the top right, or on the hotkey F2. Wires connect electrical machines, and once connected, these can be considered as on the same circuit. You don't need to have a return wire, and the order of the buildings connected by a wire doesn't matter. If a connected path can be drawn from one building to another, then they are in the same circuit. Wires and machines work only in terms of power, measured in watts, and the game has no concept of voltage, current, or any other real-world circuit properties. There are many buildings that have power interactions, but these can be categorized into one of four types. These being generators, batteries, transformers, and consumers. From a power system perspective, the exact building doesn't matter, just the type of building and its stats. I explained all the types of generators in the tutorial bite on power generation, linked in the card, and these typically have smart batteries to control them, which I also explained there. Batteries simply store charge to be used later, like in real life. They help give a reserve of energy, but beware using too many, as each one loses charge over time and makes heat. Generally, I would advise minimizing battery numbers, but solar panels usually require larger numbers to store energy during the day. Transformers will be covered later, and they do not work like real-life transformers, but are a key building for splitting high and low power circuits. Consumers are any building that draws power, and are the whole reason for making power systems. Within power systems, they can be considered interchangeable, but beware overloading wires with too many consumers, a topic that I will also explain shortly. I'm going to structure this guide by starting with simple systems, and slowly add elements to explain why each one is useful or necessary. And that brings us on to the first example circuit, which is very simple and must be built at the start of every game. This has three parts, with a manual generator, batteries, and for consumers here, the research station and oxygen diffuser. Normal wires are used, and I've run these through the tiles that make up the floor. There aren't any issues with this, but as the base grows, more consumers will be added to the circuit, which will cause two problems. Firstly, more and more duke time will be required to power everything. And secondly, the power draw may exceed the 1 kW maximum of the wires, causing overloading. So I'll explain how to solve these problems. The next circuit here has a key addition of the coal generators, which is a typical early game power source. These are controlled with a smart battery, and I explain these in full, including using them to prioritize power sources, in the tutorial bite for power generation. To recap here, an automation wire connects the battery to the generator in addition to a power wire, and this turns off the generator when the battery is full, saving fuel and heat production. Although this requires a little more research and some refined metal, I wouldn't build a coal generator, or any other fuel-consuming generator, without this. For consumers in this circuit, I have 5 gas pumps which can each draw 240 watts of power. Of course, in a real game, all kinds of consumers will be used, but remember that power systems consider all consumers the same, except for the amount of power used. Hovering over this circuit shows the current load and potential load. As none of the pumps are on, the current load is 0 watts, and the potential load is 5 times 240 watts, which is 1200 watts, or 1.2 kilowatts. Turning 4 of the pumps on, the load is now 960 watts, and the circuit is yellow as it's close to overloading. Overloading is when the maximum power limit of the wire is consumed, and for normal wires this is 1 kilowatt or 1000 watts. Importantly, this applies only to consumers, not generators. And here, the two coal generators are generating 1200 watts, but the wire is still not overloaded. Also see that the potential load is over the limit, but it's the actual load that is important for overloading. Therefore, you can have a much higher potential load, as long as you are confident that the actual load will not exceed this limit. Overloading will happen though when I turn on the 5th pump. As you can see, the circuit is now red and overloaded, so is taking damage. If left overloading for too long, the wires will break and dupes will need to repair them, which costs more metal ore. So to avoid this, there are two methods, and combining both will allow us to construct complete power systems. And the first way is to separate out multiple circuits, so each one consumes less than the wire limit. Now I've made a second circuit for the 5th pump, and we are no longer overloading. Whilst this will work fine, we've had to duplicate our generators and batteries too, which is not ideal, There is a way to recombine the generator side, which I will explain shortly, but before that we need to look at wire types. This is another way to solve the overloading issue, and there are four types of wire. The conductive wire can carry 2 kilowatts, so is useful for connecting machines that consume over 1 kilowatt, for example metal refineries or thermo aquatuners. They are made from refined metal, so can be expensive to build, but also run behind tiles like normal wires. An important note is that if any point of the circuit is above its limit, then it will still overload. In this top example, it doesn't matter that the normal wire doesn't connect to anything, it is still part of the circuit, so is overloading. In the bottom example, there is one segment of normal wire on this gas pump that is still overloading, so beware of these when playing. However, it's not that difficult to go beyond even 2 kilowatts, and so this brings us on to heavy watt wires. The basic heavy watt wire is made from large amounts of metal ore and has a power limit of 20 kilowatts, which is quite high. Heavy watt conductive wire is made from large amounts of refined metal and has a limit of 50 kilowatts, which is more than most bases will ever manage to consume or generate. So the natural question to ask is why not just use this everywhere on one giant circuit? And the main reason not to is the decor. Each wire segment has a huge minus 25 decor penalty at a range of 6 tiles, meaning if used in living areas, it is extremely difficult to counteract. Heavy watt conductive wire is better at minus 20 penalty at a 4 tile range, but is still problematic. Heavy watt wires also cannot pass through walls, so instead heavy watt joint plates must be used, which can be problematic when trying to insulate areas. It is possible to use 2 joint plates with a vacuum in the middle to perfectly insulate, and I demonstrated how to do this in the tutorial bite for liquid locks, linked in the card. The intended way to construct power systems in oxygen not included is to use heavy watt wires for generators and batteries in a high power circuit, then connect this to low power circuits for consumers. To do this, the transformer building is key to splitting the two. It has a high power side and low power side, and limits the power draw on the low side to 1 kilowatt. Combining this with the ways to prevent overloading, hopefully this clarifies how to construct a full power system. Here is an example of what this looks like in practice. The setup is similar to the last example, but now the generators and batteries have been joined by heavy watt wire. This allows the draw from all the consumers to not overload the high power side, and for low power circuits, the transformers are used. There are multiple low power circuits, each up to 1 kilowatt of consumers, that we can run to those machines. Batteries must not be placed on the low power side, as they can supply power to consumers which will overload the wires, defeating the transformer. Another point to mention is the large transformer, which does the same as a transformer but limits the draw to 4 kilowatts of power. That's beyond the 2 kilowatt limit of the conductive wire, and to be honest, I've never understood why this is 4 kilowatts and not 2. What this means is that whilst they do isolate the low power circuit from the others, they can overload if too much is consumed in their circuits. And you can see this in the top example here. This is not possible with the normal transformer and normal wires, as you can see in the middle example, and consumers will safely turn off when overconsuming. If you want to replicate this for a 2 kilowatt conductive wire, then you can connect the low sides of 2 normal transformers, as shown in the bottom example. Jumping back to the system, I've now added a large transformer that is powering an aquatuner to demonstrate a use for this. Now, this is a scheme for a complete power system, so the last point is how to apply this practically in games, and we're going to scale up the wiring. In real games, of course, power generation and consumption will be spread out across the map, so to extend the power network, a common idea is to use a heavy watt spine. This is the name given to a heavy watt wire that typically runs the entire height of the map. It's a good idea to keep this in a maintenance ladder, and away from the main transport route to avoid the decor penalty. Functionally though, this is the same system as before, only bigger. I should also note at this point that not all consumers must run off low power circuits, and you can simply add consumers to the high power side if convenient. Here is an example from one of my late game bases, and although it's a little complicated, fundamentally it is set up in the same way. There is a heavy watt spine on both sides and connected at the top, with generators, batteries, and some industrial machines grouped in the high power side. Grouping machines like this is known as an industrial brick, and I will explain these in their own tutorial bite. Here are some transformers that limit the consumption to low power circuits which then run into living areas, and commonly into aquatuners in steam rooms. So that's how to make power systems in Oxygen Not Included. I hope this helps you safely power your colony, and thanks for watching.